Here at the Barber Motorsports Museum, just outside of Birmingham, Alabama, resides arguably the single finest collection of motorcycles in the world. They bask in the glow of past glories, treasuring the revered memories of riders such as MotoGP world champion Nicky Hayden, conflicts won by men like AMA Pro and World Superbike champion Scott Russell. At the same time, they patiently await the arrival to their number of machines still competing, bikes such as the Blue Number 1, currently carrying its rider toward an unprecedented fourth consecutive Superbike championship. And they will watch from afar as Josh Hayes takes to the twists and turns of the racing facility just across the street for race two of round three in the 2013 AMA Pro National Guard Superbike Championship chase.
Today it's just been Josh Hayes' day out here at Barber Motorsports Park.
Welcome everyone to our continued coverage of the Geico Motorcycle AMA Pro Road Racing Series, presented by Yamaha, coming to you from the magnificent grounds of Barber Motorsports Park. Hi, I'm Jonathan Green, and as you already know, this monument to motorcycles is adjacent to the track itself here at Barber, and it truly is a magnificent facility. Now today, we'll be turning to the second of our AMA Pro Superbike races, and yesterday's race one had all the excitement we've come to expect. The lights were on for a long time. Both Josh Hayes and Roger Hayden jumped the lights and were caught out, as were several others. Lucky Cardenas did, but then stopped and didn't get penalized. Despite that, though, Hayes was on the hunt, soon passed Cardenas, and then slam dunking Jordan of number 54, Roger Hayden. And into the lead went Hayes, and he never looked back once again to make it three in a row in the series of wins in 2013. Hayes victorious yet again. Beautiful day here at Barber, and here's what happened in race one then. Hayes with that victory over Roger Hayden. Cardenas in third place on the Suzuki. Josh Herron in fourth. Chris Fillmore in fifth. Let's head down to Scott Russell.
Jonathan, one of the stories down here this morning was a little bit of an off by Martin Cardenas. Martin, can you tell us what happened out there?
Yeah, in qualifying, we were trying some changes to the bike, and I came into the museum turn and lost the front. Small crash, and nothing happened.
Confidence-wise, how are you feeling going into the race today?
I hope I stay the same. Good confidence for the race, and I'm hoping for a good battle and good race.
Well, good luck today. Danielle?
Thanks, Scott. I'm down here in the pits of the number 99 Jeff May EBR effort, 100% red, white, and blue going on over here. Jeff, the story this weekend, though, is the injury that you're riding with. You had your appendix taken out earlier this week. How's that coming along?
Well, I'm not 100%, obviously, so we've been just trying to get as many points as we can and soldier on. I wanted to get out here Friday initially and just see if I could ride the bike, and so far I've been able to do a pretty good job. I'm not 100%. So I don't think there's a really good shot at a podium today, but I'm going to go give it my best effort for the guys, and I'm feeling good, so we'll see.
And speaking of, how close are you guys to another podium position, much like last year?
The bike's coming along. We had high hopes for this weekend. Unfortunately, with my mishap, I don't think we're going to be there, but I would look for Mid-Ohio, Laguna, and even Miller tracks we're really strong at. We've got new products on the bike. It's constantly being upgraded, so we'll see. You know, we have high hopes for this year.
Jonathan.
Thanks, Danielle. Yes, a lot of racing still to come from the 2013 season, and we've got racing coming up, and the boys and girls in the woods here at Barber are ready for it. It's Superbike Race 2, and putting the heat on Hayes here at Barber is what it's all about. We'll be right back on the CBS Sports Network.
AMA Pro Superbike on CBS Sports Network is brought to you by 1-800-MOTORCYCLE. The lawyers at 1-800-MOTORCYCLE remind you to ride safe tonight. 1-800-MOTORCYCLE. Lawyers helping injured riders. Call or click anytime for a free consultation. by Yamaha. Yamaha is the first name in motorsports. And by True Value. For tools, products, and expert advice for all your project needs. True Value. Start right, start here.
Hey race fans, this is actor Gunnar Wright. Super excited about round three this week in Barber Motorsports. Who's gonna win it? Cardenas, Josh Hayes, who won both races in 2012. I'm gonna be watching CBS Sports Network to find out.
Thanks, Gunnar. Yeah, who are you gunning for? Well, points look like this at the moment. Cardenas still has the lead, but it's tightening up. Josh Herron still second, but here comes Josh Hayes. Third now, just 23 points adrift. Larry Pegren in fourth place. Roger Hayden in fifth. Danny Eslicks in sixth place. Fillmore seventh. And Dave Anthony in eighth position in the top 10 also. Chris Clark and Jeff May. Talking of Dave Anthony, or Aussie Dave as he's affectionately known, he does it all. He owns the team, he unloads the trucks, works on the bike, then rides the wheels off it. And there's no question, he's this afternoon's next Moto champion.
Race weekends, I sort of have a task everywhere. Something always to be done on race weekends. I wish I could just come and ride the bike, but no, it doesn't work like that. You know, I do have a crew here that comes to the racetrack and helps me out. I do have mechanics on race day. It's more the lead up to the event that really, you know, is where I'm the man, you know, behind the scenes. It's a one person team. Is it fun for me to put all this work in behind the scenes? You know, it's not fun, but you know, it's a much better job than working 9 to 5, sitting in an office or something like that, or working at a motorcycle shop. So no, I definitely enjoy it, or I wouldn't be here. You know, the passion's there, that's why I do it. You know, for me, you know, it's encouraging, you know, to think back of what we've achieved over the years. You know, it's not all me, but, you know, I'm going to pat myself on the back a little bit. You know, I've done a lot of work to get here. Definitely come in being the underdog, and that's what makes it enjoyable, is beating those people with a lot more than me and making it happen.
Hardworking Dave Anthony just might be the next Moto champion. So as we look at Aussie Dave on the grid, again, what are we going to watch out for here, Scott?
Well, hey, it's Hayes or Hayden today, maybe, and let's just see. I think number two, it's faster for Fillmore. He was fifth. He wants a podium today. And now it's time for Danny Essick to step up.
Yeah, it's a good point, Danny Eslick. I wonder whether he can actually do something and start mixing it with these boys. We'll find out. Plenty more racing to come. Race 2 from Superbikes coming up from Barber on CBS Sports Network. When it comes to revolutions in motorcycle racing, one name to me stands out, and that is John Britton of New Zealand. And this is his 1996 V1000 Britton. And it's incredible, really. He single-handedly revolutionized the way people thought about making motorcycles. Extensive use of carbon fiber for the first time, a different use of the way the swing arm is placed. Same with the shocks. Not the usual place to see the shocks mounted. But for me, one of the most interesting is the air-cooled radiator that actually cools air from the front. And the radiator is not in its usual position, it's underneath the seat. Only 10 Britons were made, sadly John passing away before his time. This is number 7, and it's special. And also special are the men are back to perform in Superbike Race 2. Josh Hayes, Roger Hayden, Martin Cardenas, and Josh Herron on the front row. Then Danny Eslick, Larry Pegram, Chris Fillmore, and Dave Anthony, who we heard from earlier. Jeff May on the EBR looking for a good result. Taylor Knapp, Dustin Dominguez got a result yesterday, wants to follow it up. Watch out also for Huntley Nash coming through on that Kawasaki. Corey West is another man looking for a result. Plenty of stories all the way through. We'll be bringing you up to date with everything as the race unfolds. Scott, again, let's take a look at what this track means, why these 14 turns are so tough.
Yeah, 2.38 miles, 14 turns. This track undulates its way. It's very difficult for the riders. It offers all kind of challenges for a 200 horsepower super bike like you're going to see today. They're going to average speeds of about 100 miles an hour. So a real handful for the riders. It's going to be a test of the tires and machine and rider.
Well, we're about to get underway, so let's head down once again to Danielle Teal.
In yesterday's race, several of the riders, including the winner Josh Hayes, were given a 5-second penalty for jumping the start. You can be certain here today, riders will be careful not to make the same mistake twice.
Very good point indeed. And here is what happened. Look, the lights are on, and Josh and Roger Hayden move quickly. So do several other riders, and away we went. And not an easy situation for these boys, and let's hope they don't make that mistake again. They'll certainly be a little bit more wary because Josh Hayes doesn't want to be thinking about that the whole race long. Here we go then, race two from Barber, round three. It's all about stopping Hayes. Can Hayden do it, Cardenas or Heron? Away we go, the green light gets underway. Both the Yamahas start well. That's a much better start from Heron. And in fact, I think he's got past his teammate in that one. Cardenas in third place, and Roger Hayden looks as though he'll have to settle for fourth place as they head through two.
Well, let's watch the number two of Heron, because he really chipped away at the lap time this morning. Hayes wasted no time as he swings up on the outside. But Heron has definitely found more time in practice this morning. He's a little bit more comfortable, but now can he stay with his teammate?
Well, once again through Charlotte's Web, and that's a classic move by Hayes. He hits the front again. Now they've got to stop him. Hayden looking for a way up the inside of Cardenas as they go into the museum. Nice move.
Both the Jordan bikes are right there in play. Estick behind Cardenas, and Roger Hayden just made that move in the museum turn. Remember, that's where Cardenas had his off this morning.
Yeah, it didn't seem as though in your interview anyway that it affected him much, and he's a very cool character from Colombia, and he doesn't seem to have too much emotion, not that Latin spirit we used to, and I think it might help him in his career.
As laid back as he is, though, he wants to win as much as anybody out there, and anything less just won't do for him. But right now, the way things are looking, he may have to settle for less than a win today.
Now, as we look at Josh Hayes, the Monster Energy Graves Yamaha man, obviously doing what he does best, which is trying to pull away. And I think if you look at what Heron's going to try and do, and likewise with Roger Hayden, they've got to stay with him in these early laps.
Well, something to watch, too, for the number two. He had that arm pump surgery. We've all heard about it. And now, you know, he had that issue bother him a little bit in yesterday's race. Today, how long will he be able to run the pace that's very going to be set hot up front, I'm sure, by Josh Hayes?
And in fact, talking of hot, the weather has changed as we had from this morning. It was quite dull, a moment there from Heron, and it was quite dull this morning, but it's hotted up now, and they're going to be feeling that heat out there. And Hayden now in third place, sliding it in on the 54.
They're already kind of dropping Essek off a little bit in the back of these four riders right now.
Cardenas!
He's looking to make a move right now, and he knows it's got to be done quick because Hayes is not going to fool around today. He kind of rode around yesterday at a good pace, but he didn't really know that Hayden was right there in the end of the race. So today he's going to want to try to make a break, but right so far everybody's been able to stay with him.
When we got here on Thursday and Friday, we were wondering what Cardenas Suzuki could come out with. And they seem confident. We talked to the team, and they felt like they'd found some horsepower. Likewise with Roger Hayden, the same thing. Is it enough yet?
Well, this is not a horsepower racetrack, let's just say that. This is more a handling racetrack. So getting the bike set up to where it'll go left and right over these high spots like that where the bike gets low, and then it loads the suspension big time here. So setup is everything at this track.
Yeah, I wonder what Cardenas is doing in terms of his mind now. As you heard, he's got to keep finishing in second place if he wants to, or at least get up there. If he wants to hold on to his overall lead. Do you think that crash has affected him?
I don't think it has, and I don't think he's really worried about the championship right now. He knows that Hayes is on a swing upward, and he knows that all he wants to do is win races. He's a one-race guy by the race guy, and if it all worked out in the end he was champ, he'd be happy about it.
Yeah, we talked to him last night. He doesn't seem like anything really fazes him much. And as we've said before, he's still learning his way. He's got nowhere near the experience of the two men, like Roger Hayden and Josh Hayes has. So I think, you know, okay, we're going to give him a little bit of a break.
That's right. And I mean, I'll tell you what, it's got to be cool, collective like he is, to be able to perform at this level in this sport. You know, you can't be all excited on the motorcycle, but it does not work. So these calm guys, they tend to be really fast.
Yep, top five, all in the 125, so good pace early on here, and this is perfect conditions for racing, and this is much better from Heron.
Well, this is much like what we saw last year. Heron had a good run, he had some issues, he kept running into a false neutral last year, and shot himself in the foot a couple of times and lost touch with his teammate.
Had a good chat with Earl, and obviously he was really giving us great insight into what it's like to be a Hayden. And Earl Hayden's the toughest of the lot, and he said that this boy has been working like he's never worked before.
Well, talk
Tommy's training with him, his older brother, and they always train together. But this guy, Roger Hayden now, he's a different guy. He's really training hard right now, and it shows in his riding.
Yeah, it does. And obviously, when you've got an example like Nicky as a world champion, and obviously Tommy rides as well, it's got to be competitive amongst the brothers. Back to last year, Roger Hayden, well, he was in all sorts of trouble, wasn't he?
Oh, yeah, he's had his ups and downs, no doubt. But he's found his way. He's got a great team in this Jordan Suzuki. Lost a bit of a finger there. A lot of riders around here like that. I think you're even missing one, too.
I've got one, too. We're in that same fraternity.
I don't know how you lost yours, but I'm pretty sure I know how they lost theirs.
I wish it was in a motorcycle accident. Roger Hayden there, 125.2. Leader 125.5, so he's on the pace, absolutely. And you can see the four of them, nothing really much between them, just 0.6. Off the lead at the moment, and early days yet, 4 and 21, but a good start from the leaders, and a clean start. More importantly, we're going to get a good race, I'm sure. Cardenas still in fourth place. Eslick is up to fifth. Pegram is sixth at the moment. Aaron Yates, good start from him. He's in seventh place ahead of Fillmore.
Great job by him. Fillmore's in the eighth spot. He finished fifth yesterday. He did good, and now looking to do better. But today the race is right here up front. Number one, he's actually, you know, these guys are learning. Every time they go on a track and they stay this close to the champ, they're learning.
You know what I'm amazed about Josh Hayes? We had a long, long chat with him last night, and he's just so cool at the moment. I mean, 5-second penalty, he's fighting with Cardenas. And he didn't even know Roger Hayden was behind him the whole time. His team weren't putting a board out saying Roger. They were just letting him know he needed to fight to get ahead and get 6 seconds ahead. And he just didn't seem to play unfazed at all.
No, he's a cool Southern boy. He doesn't worry about it. He knows he's confident. He's confident in what he can do. He knows his bike. He's got the best team and the whole deal. There's no reason he shouldn't win every race out here in the way he's going. But now, this kid, number two, Josh Heron, it's time for him to step up. Yamaha sunk a lot of money into this kid and a lot of effort, and now it's time for him to show him that he's capable of being a superbike rider and winning superbike races.
Takes a very different line to Josh Hayes. We talked about that line, and Hayes just says his setup is perfect for going into turn four, and he's able to get really, really tight through there, and that gives him the advantage, especially if he needs to overtake.
Well, the real big reason is he's kind of getting the bike upright on the fat part of the tire and saving the tire on the edge. And what happens? Coming off of that turn four, it's a lot smoother racetrack closer to the grass.
Danielle Teal's down in the pits.
With Carl Seiler, race engineer for number 54. Roger's running a really strong race. Does he have what it takes to stay with the Yamahas?
Well, we showed yesterday we could. So, the crew's been really working hard at, the National Guard, Michael Jordan Motorsports team. So I think we have what it takes today. Our bike works better late in the race. So we'll just have to see how this plays out. The pace is actually quicker today. So, we're just going to have to wait and see. I know we have a good bike late in the race, so I'm hoping.
Does Roger have any old gremlins with Barber Motorsports Park?
He's had some good moments here and some bad. So, I mean, yesterday was obviously a good moment for us, and hopefully we have another one today.
Very interesting point made there, Scott, because late in the race is where Hayden's going to be strong. And look where he is right now. He's right on top of these two. So if that's real confidence speaking. And look at this. Heron's making his move.
That was a little bit of a mistake right there. Hayes lost the front end right there at the apex, and I had to pick the bike up. That allowed his teammate to slide right up in there and take the lead. Now, what can he do with it?
Well, it makes it very interesting also from Roger's point of view, because that gives him a chink in the armor as well. Here's that
move. Look, you saw the back wheel off the ground as he turns in. He's in a little tighter. Look,
oh,
you saw the front wheel
bubble
tuck right there. So he is really pushing it. And Josh says down in that corner, he's never really breaking that hard. Well, looked like he was breaking pretty hard that time.
Well, he hit that bump, didn't he? And that really unsettled him. So Heron leads, and now Hayden's going to try and get on these two. It's an interesting race now. Number two leads number one. 54 is right behind. Tiger in the tank, or who's going to come through? Heron leads at the moment here at Barber. We'll take a short break here on CBS Sports Network. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Geico Motorcycle AMA Pro Road Racing Series from Barber Motorsports Park in Birmingham, Alabama. Round three, race two, presented by Yamaha. And it's hotting up nicely here. Look who's back in front. Yes, Josh Hayes regains the lead on, lap 9 of 21 gone. and he's in control for now anyway. And Aaron had a spate at the front and was hot footing it for a while. That's what he was doing last year. But
this is the favorite passing zone on the racetrack. We've talked about it, we've seen it all through the weekend, down the inside, the one ticket. The two decides to go in a wide entrance. I'm not sure why. And the one walks right on the in the open door and takes it back away. And the reason he did that is because when Heron got in front, the pace slowed by half a second. He realized, I can't have this. I got to get back up here and control the pace.
Yeah, and remember yesterday, Josh Heron obviously physically struggling a little bit to stay with the pace. Of course, remember last year when he was hot putting it then too, and it just got to a point where he just couldn't keep his feet on the pegs.
Well, you'll see him take his feet off the pegs. Last year, let me tell you, it was quite a bit warmer than it is here out here this weekend. So, had some issues. There's a lot of heat that rushes through the fairing on that motorcycle, and it has to escape. And it comes right out on the rider's feet and his knee. So, Heron was struggling with that. And today, well, he's got another issue, and it could be.
Big moment then for Josh Heron. Just as we talk about that, he almost loses his feet completely and bucks and rears. Whew. How did he stay on?
It looks like he just about ran into the back of his teammate right there. Maybe we can have another look at that and get a, and decide what happened. He ran wide there, another mistake. There's one, two mistakes in a row.
And here comes Cardenas too.
And that's all the two guys up front needed, that little bit of a break. Now he's going to have to fight really hard to get back on terms with them.
I bet to stay cool at this point, got to be very hard indeed. When you, I mean, first of all, you're beating yourself up for doing it. Here we go.
Here we go. We're tipping into the turn two here, right here. It's a long, grassy corner. Looks like Hayes ran out a little bit wide. The back end. Back end stepped out on him right there. Nice save. They have traction control on these bikes to kind of catch it at that point where maybe it won't flip him off the high side.
I love the way you say nice save. I mean, should I pay my electricity bill?
Well, he's made two other mistakes so far in this one lap that I've seen. He just made another slight mistake. And this is where it happens. He could be having problems with his arm right now. We talked about that. We are halfway through the 21-lap race right now. So Heron could be feeling that. Now he's feeling the heat from the 36.
And just to explain, we've talked about the arm pump with Heron before now. But what does it do to you physically? Obviously, it affects you. Is it like a cramping?
In his case, it's the right hand, which is the most important, and it controls the throttle and the brake. So what happens was the blood gets full in the right arm, forearm, and you start to lose feeling in your right hand. And when you can't feel the front brake lever or the throttle, you got to slow down.
That's bad news.
Or fall down.
Well, one who's doing neither of that is Danielle Teal.
With the crew chief of number two, Rick Hobbs. Rick, Josh is out there battling his heart out with the number one of Josh Hayes. What's going on out there? He just had a little bit of a moment.
Yeah, it looked like he got a little anxious on the throttle and slipped out on him, lost a position. He's still looking pretty strong out there. Hopefully it's not a problem. It's going to come back again. We'll hope for the best and see how it plays out at the end.
Good words from Rick Hobbs. And, you know, you did that piece in the pre-show earlier in the weekend about, you know, how to ride these things. And it's really a delicate orchestration of, you know, hind-eye coordination.
Well, I showed you how the controls work. And it's key to position yourself on the motorcycle to where the weight's not on your hands. So you're using your flags, your weight, your foot pegs more. And that allows you to free up the fingers that control these controls. And that's so key to have that light touch, a linear input into every control on the bike. When you start to lose feeling like that, you lose the ability to control that.
Yeah, I've heard it described as ballet at 140 miles an hour, and it's a little bit that way. You've got to be very, very deft with your touch.
It's not rock and roll, it's a symphony.
Yeah, I like that too. Talking of which, will Mr. Cardenas orchestrate a move here on the number two, Josh Heron?
He's doing all he can. It looks like they don't really have the setup, but let's remind you that the pace is faster than yesterday.
Here's the battle for seventh place. Jeff May leading Chris Fillmore. We spoke to him earlier, and it's good to see these two going at it. I'm amazed, actually, that May's doing so well as he is, given the week he's had.
Oh, I know, but I'll tell you what, if nobody ridden an EBR quite as good as I think Jeff May has, Danny Essick had some good races last year, but consistently the 99, has shown him how to ride the EBR, but look in the background, the 20. He's on an EBR too, and there goes Taylor Knapp. He makes the move on Dave Anthony as they dive down into turn four.
Well, Chris Fillmore is the new pain in Mr. May's side. Having had the appendix, he's now got Fillmore to deal with. So we've got a couple of beat-up boys out there, but look at him sliding his rear around there. You wouldn't notice, would you?
No, a lot of these riders, they're used to riding hard. I mean, that's what the sport's all about. If you get hard, you take yourself up. You do whatever you can to get back on the bike as quick as you can.
just behind them. Just saw Aussie Dave too. He's in ninth position on the 25. And Taylor Knapp, Yates is in 11th place. So.
Yeah, Yates, I talked to him this morning. He was much happier than yesterday. Feels like they're making some progress here today. And this is a real rider's track. You know, these bikes we're showing now are down on horsepower when you compare them to the Suzuki and the Yamaha. So these guys were able to shine at a racetrack like this.
Scott, got to update you. A 24-6 from Hayden. As we watch this battle, he's just up the pace again on Hayes.
That's quick.
Very quick indeed.
That's the quickest lap of the weekend, I'm pretty sure.
I think it is.
In a race situation, that's impressive. And you heard his crew chief talk about this. Suzuki will get better as the race goes on.
Well, he's got plenty of time, too. 9 laps to go. So getting very interesting indeed for the race lead.
And the gap's only 0.2 of a second between Hayes and Hayden by that last time by the game.
Jeff May on the 99, gets the foot out, a la Rossi. Dave Anthony on the 25, sliding it in past the 44 of Taylor Knapp.
Such an intense corner. When you come over the top of that hill, the bike gets light. You're loading the front end with the brakes on it. The back end's trying to pass the front, and you're asking the front tire to grip when it really doesn't want to. They're pushing it so hard in there. Feel a little bit of a moment right there for Fillmore as he turned the bike in. Saw the back end step out, just a small thing right there. But those small things can add up in a rider's mind as the race goes on. And lose a little bit of trust in maybe the tire.
Aaron Yates at the back of this gap. There he is, number 20. Could see the older fella still going.
Oh, yeah, he's a scrapper, this guy, man. And nobody rides harder than Aaron Yates. And when he gets something he can really work with, he's a real special rider. And everybody's seeing some signs of that right now.
Let's head down to Danielle Teal.
Chris Fillmore's crew chief, Uli Tepors. Uli, big strides for Chris this weekend. He had a little bit of a moment here, but big strides.
Yes, he was really good yesterday. And we're trying to get something similar again today. I still hope it turns out good, but at the moment it doesn't look like. So we'll see how it ends up.
Yep, still some development to do, but KTM are coming forward and it's good to see. More manufacturers, more different designs and marks of motorcycle. Good to see EBR as well up there this weekend.
And that KTM's like a work of art.
It is,
really,
isn't it?
Look,
yeah.
At it. It's a beautiful motorcycle.
Well, that was a work of art. That move by Dave Anthony up the inside there. Nicely done. Slides it in. What a job he puts together at the weekend, as you heard there earlier. He does it all.
It's hard, you know, you try to do that much stuff and then be the rider. I mean, ultimately, that's not the way you want to do it. But right now, the way it's worked out, that's how they have to do it. So maybe there'll be the day where he'll just be the rider and he'll have a guy to do all the other stuff that he has to do.
Now, back with the leaders. And Roger Hayden, as we heard, just put in a 124.6. And that's almost what it was, the quickest lap of the weekend, I think, and he really is pushing hard now. And now with 7 to go, as his crew chief said, he's coming into his own on the National Guard machine.
Does it show you how important it is for these riders to train as hard as they do? I mean, look at Roger, he's like a different rider all of a sudden. He's really put the time in, off the track at home, and now it's showing right here in Barber today.
Well, there's Rocks on the track as well. Johnny Rocks ahead of them, and their blue flags are waving. An ally yesterday, they've got it. There they are, getting out of the way, thankfully. And the back markers not getting in or impeding this battle for the lead.
They weren't happy with him yesterday, Roger, with the blue flags, but today he did a good job of getting out of their way.
Roger seems so good and so comfortable under the braking and slower parts here at Barber, but then just seems to lose a little bit of pace on top end.
Well, it's hard to say. It's not so much of a top-end race. So you're talking about 150 mile an hour of top speed. These bikes are capable of 220, 215. We've seen it.
So Roger Hayden giving some grief to Mr. Hayes. But which H is going to come through at Barber and take the sting out of the tail? We'll soon find out. Josh Hayes leads at the moment ahead of Hayden and Heron. We'll be right back here on CBS Sports Network. We're here at Barber Motorsport Park to talk about motorcycles, of course, so you may be wondering why we're looking at this Ferrari. Well, the significance is it won the Formula One World Championship back in 1964 at the hands of Britain's John Surtees.
But before he did that, the significance is John Surtees had another career in motorcycles. Here's his 1957 NV Agusta. And during the late 50s, he went on to win 7 motorcycle world titles and remains today the only man in history to win both motorcycle and car world championships.
An incredible feat that I don't think will ever be repeated. Welcome back to the AMA Pro Superbike Series from Barber Motorsport. A good battle with 4 to go between Josh Hayes, the champion, and Roger Hayden on the 54, Jordan Suzuki. And Roger doing a superb job, a 24.5, he upped the pace again. And obviously Hayes is going pretty quick too. Plenty of support from around the world. Justin Allgaier from Nationwide had something to say.
This is Justin Allgaier, driver of the number 31 in the NASCAR Nationwide Series. You're watching AMA Superbike on CBS Sports Network. Good luck to my buddy Josh and all the other riders out there. Hopefully you guys put on a great race today.
Well, obviously that good luck helped as doing the business, and it's good to have some support from different forms of motorsport. And I always forget that, you know, every Sunday afternoon, everybody's busy, but everybody's watching to see who did what at Le Mans and who did what in the Nationwide or in the Sprint Cup. And of course, it's great to see the following of AMA continues.
Definitely, there's a lot of road racing fans out there, and it goes crosses over in all different sports. So they realize what it takes to ride. They don't, I don't think, but they understand this is special individuals that are able to do these.
Well, I think that's
things.
The thing, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, the car guys really do just amaze themselves. The Indy guys come here as well. And if they saw them going into Charlotte's Web the way they do, they'd be like, whoa, on a bike? No way. You know, it's so hard. So what does Hayden have to do? The gap just 0.2, and you can see it visually here. But where and when does he make his move? Here's another battle. Danny Eslick in fifth place and Larry Pegram just behind him in sixth. And you've been saying Danny needed to step up. You know that this kid has got such talent.
He really does. I tell you, he just hadn't found the right setup. That's the bottom line. He finds something he's happy with. And, you know, sometimes it's just a click or two away or a fork spring away. And here he goes.
He's got a big heart.
Yeah, he really does. In memory of right here.
Yeah, Jason Leffler, that obviously lost his life. And that's a really nice moment for him to remember him and put it on his helmet this weekend. And I think that's just it just shows you how special and what a fraternity motorsports is.
That's right. But yes, that's the setup on Danny's bike. I think he's just not comfortable with the front end of the motorcycle. And that means it's not chattering, it's not doing anything wrong. It just doesn't have the feel when he turns it in. So instead of throwing a bunch of lean angle at it, he's kind of tiptoeing into the corner, and you really can't ride hard that way.
Larry Pegram last night complaining about chatter, especially in the last sector, coming up the hill to finish that right-hander. And again, you explained chatter yesterday, but basically the whole bike shudders and really just makes it uncomfortable to ride, especially the corners like this, I would have thought. Back to the lead.
It just limits how fast you can go. And right here, though, these guys right here aren't limited at all. They're unlimited, and they're ripping this racetrack apart. With the 54, I don't know where he's going to try to make a move. It's really going to have to be maybe a mistake by the number one. They look so equal pretty much all the way around the racetrack.
Well, if you look back to yesterday, we talked to Roger Hayden last night because it looked as though to us he was trying to make a move on the last lap of the inside. But Josh kind of spooked him a little bit because he took a different line, and that meant he couldn't make the line he wanted to. So Roger will be thinking about that now and planning.
In this area right here you're talking about, he said Josh was taking a tighter line, so I almost set up on the outside of him and try to make that dive move on the last turn. But on the last lap, Josh let the bike drift out a little bit wide, and Roger committed to the outside, really left him nowhere to go.
All right, gloves off, and it's the final lap. Roger Hayden versus Josh Hayes, the champion.
There may be a shot at him down here in turn 4. He was good there yesterday. He's got to get the perfect drive. He can't. That just killed it right there. That little bit of a bobble.
That wasn't
the perfect
drive.
That was a shot at it, but he's too far back now.
Yeah.
So he'll regroup and he'll look for another spot. There's really nothing at the end of this straightaway down here. It's just too tight. They're too equally matched. You'd almost take each other out if you tried something at the end of this straight.
And watching them as they get under acceleration, you can see that the Yamaha's more planted, and obviously Roger's still struggling to get out of the corner and get the pace he wanted to. There's some back markers. Could that be a factor?
It could be.
No? Thankfully not.
That's a Huntley Nash getting right out of the way. Nice job. These bikes, 200-plus horsepower. They're really hard to ride, and these guys are really stretching for anything they can right now. He's not close enough to make a move here.
It's going to be all or nothing on those last two corners, isn't it? Here we go. Time running out. Race two. Josh Hayes going for the double here at Barber.
Roger's slipping and sliding around. He's struggling with the rear. Right now, there's really nothing there. Now, unless he just leaves it all on the table right here.
Well, he's thinking about it, but I don't think he's going to get close enough. But it's been a valiant effort by Roger Hayden. But here comes the man of the moment. Josh Hayes makes it four in a row here at Barber as he takes the checkers. And that was another masterful display. Thumbs up from the team. Well, what can you say about this man? Here we go. Larry Pegram fighting hard to get his position.
Look at Larry, stays low right there. Doesn't give Danny any opportunity. Danny might try something down here on the inside. He thinks better of it there again. The confidence in the front was not there.
Pegram then's going to hold on. Eslick's looking over his shoulder, and he can't get any further. And he's got a problem, it looks like, as they cross the line.
No, he just can't believe that just happened to him.
Here's that battle further back with Chris Fillmore. On the number 11, coming to the line, and look, it's close. Jeff May then comes across the line in eighth position. Fillmore takes seventh, Taylor Knapp just behind him in ninth, and Dave Anthony makes the top 10. Josh Hayes, though, with victory, and the rest of the field needs to wonder what to do to beat this wheeling man of the moment. Let's head down to Danielle Teal.
With the crew chief, Jim Roach. Jim, the emotion down here, everybody's excited. Did you expect anything less out of Josh knowing you came in here back with a vengeance?
No, that's exactly what he likes to do, is to get out there and lead everything. But this is always a hard, it's always close racing, and Roger put on another great race. And it really comes down to the riders and the fitness and everything that happens on track. So I'm really happy to be back here again.
And with Cardenas having the weekend he did, you guys were able to capitalize on that in terms of points.
Yeah, I think we'll be within 10 points, and that just puts us in at least the window for each race, and that's all we're after right now. Thanks.
So Josh Hayes does it, and the rest of the field need to smell the roses and wake up to what is happening to them, because Hayes is taking them to the cleaners here. Hurricane Hayes at Barber. We'll take a short break.
AMA Pro Superbike on CBS Sports Network is being brought to you by 1-800-MOTORCYCLE. The lawyers at 1-800-MOTORCYCLE remind you to ride safe tonight. 1-800-MOTORCYCLE. Lawyers helping injured riders. Call or click anytime for a free consultation. By GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on motorcycle insurance. Get a free rate quote today. And by Cox Racing Group Radiator Guard. Run what the pros run.
Another emphatic win by Josh Hayes, the current champion, as he marches on. That's four in a row, and he's with Daniel Teal down in the pits.
Congratulations to the defending champ, number one, Josh Hayes. Josh, you won another race here at Barber Motorsports Park, but you had to work for it very hard again.
Man, I love a good race. Roger rode so good. I was pushing so hard. The lap times were great, faster than yesterday through most of the race, and I just had a great time. I had the bike to be on. I love that Monster Energy R1, and you know, hey, special day. My friend Al Slide, happy birthday, Al, and Gina, boss, I wish you were here to see it. Miss you guys, mom and dad, too. Hope you guys are watching live, CBS. But no, awesome day. Love my crew, everything about it. Dunlop did an incredible job. We were fast throughout the race. What else do I say? I don't know.
Pretty much sums it up, doesn't it? Yep, number one, and headed to California dreaming after this. He's got the U-Haul going, and he's ready to head out there. The moments of the race, though, well, Heron led for a while, but look at this slide into the lead. And a bit of a moment as he went wide, and that allowed Heron back through. Well, he didn't lose his cool, though, and it wasn't long before he was doing the same thing again at Charlotte's Web. This time, a lot more smooth. And once in the lead, Heron would drop off, and then it was left to Roger Hayden to pick up the fight, which he did, too. And he took it to Josh Hayes, so he didn't have it all one-way traffic. But another win for number one. And it's been an emphatic day. And surely, with the museum just by the wayside, he's making his name in history right now. So the final results then. Hayes with victory over Roger Hayden on the Suzuki. Josh Heron in third place over Martin Cardenas in fourth. Larry Pegram holding off Danny Eslick for fifth place. A little further down. Good battle at the back. Corey West getting into the points. Kelsey further down. Right at the back, 22nd place, Ryan Kerr. Let's head down to Danielle Teal. She's got Roger Hayden.
That's right, number 54, Roger Hayden. Roger, two races, 2 second places here this weekend. You even ran the fastest pace of this race with a 24.6. Slight bobble there at the end that may have cost you that first place.
Yeah, you know, we start sliding around there a little bit at the end. Just, you know, so hot out, the tires, you know, 21 laps is a long time. But we had a good pace, and, you know, I just couldn't find a good spot to pass early, and I was just waiting on the last lap and just spun up a few times. But, you know, all in all, it was a good weekend for us. We had pace to win and push Josh, and that's what we got to do. And, you know, just stay up there, and eventually we're going to knock him off. But I can't thank all the men and women in National Guard enough. They do so much for our team. And, you know, Michael Jordan Motorsports, our whole crew, Gatorade, Alpine Stars, Arai Helmets, you know, all my fans back home. And, you know, I'm looking forward to Ohio and try to get one more step.
And who's this biggest fan you got right here?
This is my niece, Claudia. Can you say hi?
Jonathan, back to you.
She's a sweetie. She's got an owie, I noticed, on her knee, so she's been in the wars too. Thumbs up then for the Haydens. Great day at the races. And Roger's moving forward too. Here are the points after three rounds. Cardenas, that lead now down to 10 points as Josh Hayes moves from third to second place. And that's significant because Hayes is on his way. Good day for also Danny Aslick up sixth place. Chris Fillmore's had a good weekend in seventh now. Anthony in eighth ahead of May and Clark. Let's head down now to Danielle Tim.
Number two, Josh Aaron, third place here today. You ran a great race. You even led your teammate there for a minute. Ultimately, what cost you the victory you could have had?
I think just a combination of that big bobble in two, and then maybe a little bit of my fitness. You know, I was struggling in the middle yesterday and today, and for some reason my heart rate gets high, and then it drops, and then at the end I'm able to recover and start doing some good times again. I'm just thankful we were able to pull away from Cardenas, and Monster Energy Graves Yamaha crew worked hard all weekend. I just got to thank my sponsors, Bell Power Sports, Dionysi Leathers, Oakley Glasses, Element Case, just everybody, and my whole crew. Thanks to Yamaha for always believing in me.
Nice words then from Heron. Still struggling a little bit with fitness, and he's got to get on top of it because it's going to definitely hamper him as the season goes on, Scott.
Well, obviously, that's what his teammate's so good at. So you kind of just look at what he's doing and kind of model your program after that is what I would think he should do. And obviously, it's working for Josh Hayes.
All right, thanks, Scott. Let's head down to Danielle. She's busy, busy, busy.
Number 99, Jeff May. Jeff, we wanted to follow up with you after our story. You're suffering from an injury. You had your appendix taken out earlier this week. How did it affect you during this race?
I'm just out of gas. The heat's really taking the wind out of me, and that's probably one of the hardest races I've ever had in my racing career, but I was motivated. The bike was working great, and I just wanted to get a good finish for the guys and get as many points we could, so it was a good day.
I would absolutely argue that's a phenomenal day, really, to be out there in the hot sunshine. It's hard enough, but to be riding a motorcycle at that speed so quickly after that appendix is incredible.
Yeah, again, the 99 of May, the top EBR, and he rides it so well. So just wait till he gets healthy. Mid-Ohio, that's a great track for that bike.
Well, Danielle Teal's down with Cardenas, I believe.
And with the number 36, Martin Cardenas. Martin, you didn't really have the pace today. I know you were up there in the beginning. Look at disappointment on your face.
Yeah, a little bit. I think I let down a little bit the team because we had a high expectation for this track. And about we improved a little bit today, but I think everybody improved. The pace was a little bit faster and was kind of the same way as yesterday. I was there at the beginning, but I couldn't hang on. I didn't have the pace. And No, there's nothing more that I could do. Just try next race and try to be better.
Scott and Jonathan?
Thanks, Danielle. Great work down in the pits. And yeah, pretty much that's exactly it, Scott. Try harder.
That's right. Well, at least we got a real challenger in Hayden. It's going to be a great season.
Yeah, and it's very interesting. It's hotting up nicely. Everybody knows the eye on the prize is stopping Josh Hayes. But Hayes is ever present, and the hurricane that is Hayes is moving fast through the countryside, heading next to Mid-Ohio. But the gap now down to 10 seconds. Hope you enjoyed our production. We'll be back next time from Mid-Ohio.
and his guys were just a tick better than us this weekend. So